Good evening. It looks like people are joining us very quickly right now. This is face-to-face conversations from Kanuga, and I'm Michael Sullivan, the president of Kanuga, and it's great to have everyone joining us on a cool, if not cold, December night. I'm really excited about our conversation this evening. I'm going to be talking with Mia Hall, who is the director of the Penland School of Craft, and just a little bit about her, a native of Sweden. She holds an MFA in furniture design and woodworking from San Diego State University out in California. And before coming to Penland in 2017, she was a faculty member for 10 years at the University of Arkansas at Little Rock, where she was also chair of the Department of Art and Design. But we're going to be talking about her work at Penland mostly tonight. I do want to mention that her own personal work, primarily in furniture and mixed media sculpture, has been shown all over the country and internationally. And for us here locally, if you're in our area, at Blue Spiral in Asheville. But Mia, it's great to welcome you to Face to Face. Good evening.
Thank you so much for having me. I'm very excited to have this conversation with you tonight.
Well, many of the people that are joining us tonight know about Penland, but you wanted to share a little bit with us at the beginning to sort of provide some context. So I'm going to let you take over from here.
Absolutely. And I'm going to apologize up front because we're going to go a little deeper into technology here. So I'm going to start by sharing my screen. If things go quiet for a second, that's what's going on.
A studio for me is a place to learn, whether I'm learning from someone or teaching myself through experimenting. I guess a craftsperson, that's what being in the studio is for me.
I think practicing is something that's disposable and just kind of extra, but I think it's actually really important. We need beautiful, well-made things in our life. We need objects that make us ask questions, to take us out of ourselves and out of the gray boxes that we live in.
Using your physical body to make the thoughts in your mind come into the world. There's not much that you can do that's more beautiful than that.
I think it's crucial. And I think also, as an artist, it's a way of feeling connected within the world.
Penland is one of the most supportive communities that I'm a part of.
It's just this self-selected group of people who are really enthusiastic about this kind of an experience. Even when there's a language barrier, even when there's an age difference or a total cultural difference, I feel like we have this common language of craft.
I'm not a professional artist, but I'm sitting next to people that's their livelihood. You're here with 16 studios worth of people, and every one of them wants to share with you what they know.
Every time that I teach, I learn something. I think that's a natural thing that happens. There's collaborations in the works, students teaching students, integration of materials. Like every day, new possibilities open. I think people grow so quickly because it's so intensive. We're living, breathing, talking about it. It's completely immersive.
What's different about studying at Penland is that there's kind of a singular focus that we're able to have. Everyone is kind of in the same space and very much focused on their hands and their work. When I'm really absorbed with the project, I feel like I don't see anything else now.
And there's still always that excitement. Learning a new technique, feeling like I'm getting better at it, and then getting to apply it to a finished piece.
Have a sense of accomplishment that can't be quantified.
There's a huge reward out of that because as much as objects mean to me, it's really so much more about the process.
If there was an end game to this, why bother? I've seen so many times here that the classes gain their own sense of momentum that everyone feels can help to stay up. When you're here, you can always design a little bit beyond your actual capabilities because you know that you have people around you who will help you get there.
I know how much better something can be if I push the limits a little bit, even of just my own thinking.
That kind of experience is pretty unifying, I think.
Students that come here are really breaking and pushing those boundaries, which is really exciting. It's magic. It really is, and I love that.
At Penland, transformative things happen on a daily basis.
What a beautiful introduction, Mia.
Yes, it is. We're very, very proud of that video. And of course, we're very, very proud of the school and the campus.
So before we jump into a discussion about craft and potentially spirituality, I want to say to everyone gathered, if you have a relationship with Kanuga, it was pre-COVID, Mia, our management team came to Penland, largely because our executive vice president, Jim Hackney, is on the board there at Penland, and we wanted to come and see what you did and how your campus worked. And it was an incredible day. It was a beautiful day. But for people gathered, there's actually a pretty cool connection between Kanuga and Penland. And we're not going to dwell there very long, but I just want to mention that Rufus Morgan, who was instrumental in Kanuga's first years, was an Episcopal priest and served in the area of Western North Carolina for many years. And his sister, Lucy, had worked in the area around Penland at the Appalachian School. And it was Lucy that in 1929 really gave birth to what became Penland. Anything you want to say about your founder, Mia? I've just been so fascinated reading the history about her.
Yeah, she was a pretty remarkable woman. I mean, she was really a pioneer of her time. If you think about it, she was a woman who in 1920 came to Penland to teach at the Appalachian School, but developed a vision for this area. And she had two goals with that vision. One was to revitalize the hand weaving skill, which had pretty much died out, not just in the area, but in the country by the 1920s. But also, she wanted to give the local women a means to have a little bit of an income without leaving the home, which was incredibly important for them. So that's how she came to develop the Penland School.
Well, it is a remarkable history because in just a little bit of reading, I came to know a woman of incredible tenacity, mm-hmm. who really saw craft and creation as experiential learning. We were laughing right before everyone joined us. She was pretty bold. I mean, she invited people from Chicago and New York and all these different places in the early days, and they came, you know. But it was that the more I read about her, the more I appreciated that the art of craft was a kind of intellectual liberation for her. Mm-hmm. And I found it just fascinating to read about her. So it's great to have the connection between Rufus and Lucy Morgan and Kanuga for our conversation tonight. Mia, I wonder, how do you think about creativity? I mean, do you have a definition or anything that you could say to us about creativity and craft? What is it? You know, sort of a baseline for everyone.
Yeah, well, I think Patrick Beggs said it really well in the video we just watched. He said that using your physical body to make the thoughts in your mind come into the world. I think that is one of the most beautiful quotes I've heard. And I use it all the time to explain what it is we do here and really what craft is. Of course, creativity, it exists on so many levels. But for me, when I talk about creativity, it has to include the use of the imagination or an original idea. It has to go beyond just the act of making. The mind has to also be actively engaged. So that's how I think of creativity.
So take us a little deeper into that. You know, I immediately, as you know, I am an Episcopal priest. And so I hear these things and I think about them also as they relate to our spirit and who we are. When you were saying that about the definition of craft or the creativity, I was immediately thinking of Carl Jung and how for Carl Jung, creativity was the expression of something that is within us that is almost preconceptual. Mm-hmm. He might even call it a deeper reality for us. So you're an artist, so let's not make you the executive director of Penland School of Craft for a second. How about we talk about you and how do you cultivate a life of creativity and craft?
Ooh, how do I cultivate a life of creativity? It's a really interesting question. And, you know, it's a question that has come up many, many times throughout my life because I have primarily been in the creative field since, you know, my mid-20s. And it's a hard one to answer. And I would actually like to dodge that question just for a second and bring it over to another question. And that is, can art and creativity be taught? Mm-hmm. Because that's a discussion that I think go hand in hand. And it's a discussion that I've had many, many times with my husband. And for those of you who are married or in long-term relationships, you know that there's always that one discussion where you can't ever fully come into agreement. And this is ours. Because when I think of art and what can be taught, I'm of the opinion that technique can be taught. Creativity is inherent. It's something that is within you. There was a book written, and now I'm drawing a blank on the author, but it was a book titled Being an Introvert in a World That Can't Stop Talking. I don't know if you remember that. It's from about 8-10 years ago. And in there, she's saying that it takes about 10,000 hours to become a master of something. So then I kept thinking about teaching art and teaching creativity versus teaching technique and teaching procedure with materials. And in my argument with my husband, I always use myself in dancing as an example. I'm from Sweden, as you said, and I'm a stereotypical Swede. I could not find rhythm if my life depended on it. So I always ask him, do you really think I could be taught to dance? I mean, I could probably learn the techniques, I can learn the steps, but will I ever become a choreographer? Can I ever find that creative spark that is needed to just use the technique and create. And I really don't think so. So I think that technique can be taught, but I don't think that creativity can be taught. Can you teach someone how to become or how to find creativity? Absolutely. You can show someone, these are the exercises. This is how you can think about how to start a project, how to become inspired. But I don't think you can actually teach someone to find that spark. That has to happen from within someone within themselves. It can't mm-hmm. really be taught. So having said all of that, the way I go about finding that creative spark is really very intuitive. I gave up trying to figure out how it happens a long time ago, and I just kind of let it happen. And I think many artists will struggle trying to tell you how it happens, because it just happens. You can do a lot of research. You can go through all the exercises you go through to become inspired, but when that new piece pops up in your head, it just happens.
Right. Well, you know, having looked at your portfolio, I would say you can indeed dance. but I guess what I'm saying there is that we don't all work in the same medium. Mm-hmm. But all of us are ultimately creatives. And for me, in my language, I would say that we are created beings. Mm-hmm. And therefore, to participate in creativity is to participate in our own authentic selves as we were created to be. And so sometimes it's just finding what's the medium. You know, you've done furniture making and sculptural forms, mixed media sculptural forms. That's your dance, so to speak, for me. This idea, though, of technique, and anyone can be taught a technique. And then this concept that you had or mentioned about 10,000 hours. That's a lot of technique.
4.5 years if you do it 40 hours a week.
Right. And so it takes a while for, I guess, for the interior life and the creative technique to marry one another, to find a kind of freedom and liberation for expression is what I would, the way I would try to capture it. Mm-hmm. So, you know, I think that everyone, not to get into a marital argument, right? But I do think that everyone has a creative spirit. We might not all be sculptors or painters or jewelry makers, potters, but there's something within each of us that yearns toward the creative. So I love that's a conversation that you all have together.
Well, it helps that we were both professors, art professors for a long time. So those were the discussions we ended up with.
So let's switch, if we can, just for a second now to Penland. You attract people that are professional artists who come to cultivate their technique and their creative life. You also attract people that have really never worked with metal or pottery. Tell us about that and what that's like for you as the director.
Yeah, it makes for a very exciting place in terms of education. And I spent a long time in higher ed, 10 years as a professor. And I constantly had this little feeling that was nagging me that we were teaching things the wrong way. And I found what felt right when the first time I taught at a school like Penland. It wasn't Penland. I had actually never taught here before I became the director. Penland was always my husband's place. He taught here a number of times before we came here. But every time I taught in a place like this, it just felt so right. And the reason for that was this singular focus, the fact that people come together not because they're a sophomore in college or they have chosen furniture design, but because they have chosen to come to a place like Penland to be part of this community. We see people from 18 to 80 in the same class. There are people that are lawyers, doctors, investment bankers sitting next to, you know, college freshmen. We have people that have had a lifelong career in the arts sitting next to someone who's never touched the material in the past. And that's a very broad range of both the walks of life people come from and also levels of experience. And for someone who's never taught a class at a place like Penland, they can get a little nervous because how do you teach someone, how do you teach a group that is so broad and yet it works every single time? And there's something really special that happens when people come to Penland and they leave everything at home. We're a little remote, so no one's gonna just kind of step out and go to dinner because there's nowhere to go. So they stay here, they eat here. We provide people with everything and they kind of disconnect. They leave their lives at home and become very present in the moment. Our studios are open 24/7. And there's a real sense of urgency that sets in right away. People want to take advantage of being here. And then there's this sense of generosity that kicks in almost immediately. Our instructors are incredible. They come from all over the country, all over the world. Some of them have incredible resumes, and still they take time out of their summer to come here and to share their knowledge. I very rarely get a sense of that someone's holding back because they want to guard their secrets. It's almost the other way around, where I want to tell someone, don't give it all away. You know, that's your professional secrets right there. But there is this incredible generosity that happens. And it's not just between student and instructor. It happens between students too, because if there's someone that's struggling a little bit, may fall behind, it's just as common for the student sitting next to the person struggling to reach over and say, hey, let me give you a hand. Let me explain that to you. So it's very different. It was that kind of educational setting that I was extremely drawn to and tried to duplicate at the university. And we were successful for a couple of summers, but it was still, people didn't live in the studio the way they do here. But there is something I think very right about the way we're educating people. I think this could actually work if it's not just at the craft, in a craft program, but if you think about how we educate our youth in general, there's always this constant stop and start, up and go. There's very little time to focus. But of course, that would mean redesigning the whole educational system in the U.S., and that's not what we're going to talk about today.
Well, you know, having visited Penland, I would say that I experienced it as community. Mm-hmm. And so the community of great hospitality, but it also struck me that it was a place of great safety. where being vulnerable was okay.
Yeah, that's the other aspect of programs like this. And I just want to say that this is not unique to Penland. This is what these craft schools, primarily summer craft schools, but some of them operate year round. But this workshop model, they all have that in common. But the other thing that we don't do that you would see in academia is the evaluation. We don't have art critiques. We don't evaluate. We don't assign grades because we have all come to realize that an accomplishment for me may not be an accomplishment for you. You know, growth for one person is not growth for another. And it's impossible to just assign what success is and even have that dialogue. So it rarely happens here. There's a lot of support. There's a lot of constructive feedback, you know, especially when it comes to technique and manipulating materials. But it is a very, very safe. It's a place where you can safely fail over and over again and still come out feeling like you have accomplished something.
What a wonderful description. I mean, I think for me, having dabbled a little bit in art, when I would find myself, if you will, I don't want to say successful, but when I found a piece that I had created in a studio that spoke to me, something that I wanted to keep, hold on to, if you will, it was because it was as if the technique took over and I sort of lost a sense of self. And I might have set out to create one thing and it may have morphed into another. But it was only because I was surrounded by people that were loving, caring, non-judging, wanted me to find a way to express, that weren't going to grade me. Mm-hmm. And I think that's, for me, what I hear. You're describing that kind of environment, community that encourages creativity, because the container, if you will, is not merely about technical skill, but creating space and community where the freedom of expression is celebrated.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, very much so. I have a colleague here, Joan Glenn, that often describes the Penland programs as you don't have to be a serious artist, but you have to be very serious about creating art. And I hear her say that, especially when people get a little nervous about attending Penland, because when you look in our catalog, it looks very professional. You know, we have 16 wonderful studios. They are very well equipped, it could feel a little intimidating. But we're always trying to tell people that we really are for everyone, you know, from beginner and up. You just have to be really serious about wanting to be here and wanting to put your whole 2 weeks into it. There's no sneaking off to Asheville to go look at galleries or going out to dinner. Very few people want to do that. Once they're in the studio, they typically don't want to leave.
Right. Well, I can tell you, having had a wonderful meal there, I wouldn't want to leave. The food was incredible. It's delicious.
Yeah, they do. It's interesting. The people here take everything they do very seriously. So, of course, we have wonderful studios and we have artists here, hundreds of them in our immediate community that create wonderful works of art. But our kitchen folks, they are equally creative and they take what they do just as seriously. So yes, we do have really good food.
So you've been there at Penland now for about 3 years.
Mm-hmm. 3 years and 6 days.
There you go. No one would have expected that last March we would face this pandemic. I'm wondering if you might tell us a little bit about Penland in the midst of the pandemic and how it has affected you and what your plans are for the future.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, who could have thought that? I mean, you're new at Kanuga too. I mean, did you for a second think that anything like this could happen? When I was contemplating taking this job, I sat down and I tried to imagine what would the worst thing that could happen be, and is that something that I could handle? And I came up with a number of horrific scenarios. And then I thought, well, the very worst thing that could happen is that we would lose the whole season and we would lose all our income. That's not going to happen. I mean, what is that scenario, right? I got a little nervous recently that I may have jinxed myself and us by even thinking like that. It has affected us just like all cultural institutions across the country. It is an alarming moment in our society, and I think we're gonna feel this for at least a decade, because I see so many museums and art organizations folding right now because they simply can't pay the bills and they can't stay open, and that fallout is gonna be felt. Because this is the creative sector. I personally feel that we're the backbone of everything that goes on. I know that view might not be shared because there's so little funding going into the creative sector. If I compare it to, you know, my native country, Sweden, where a large percentage of the national budget is dedicated to the cultural life of Sweden, and schools like ours would be supported by the government, but that's not the way it works here. I see how many programs are shutting down in higher ed, and of course that's alarming because that's our next generation of artists coming up through college programs, and when the programs are not offering ceramics or glass blowing anymore because it's just too expensive, they will never have had that experience. And it makes me worried because how can you know that you want something if you've never had the experience? So how can you know that you want to take a pottery class at Penland if you've never touched clay? And that makes me a little worried for the next generation. But of course, I also think that we're in a time where schools like Penland are going to have a pretty big responsibility for picking up the slack, basically. We have to find ways to make ourselves available so that this knowledge is not lost. The opportunity to come and take these classes, that it's not gone. So that's what I see, you know, the next 10 years being for schools like ours. But to be more specific, we canceled classes for a whole year, which of course is well over half of our income. We are amongst the very lucky few, and we do realize how lucky we are. We received a large endowment gift just 2 years ago. That extra income, coupled with some large gifts that could be redirected into operations, has floated us for this year. And I am very grateful to our donors and the people who have made this happen, because it has allowed us to keep our entire staff of almost 70 people on. And what a gift for Penland, because we've gone 8-9 months without any students. So Our campus has never been cleaner. You know, every gutter has been emptied, every filter has been changed, and you know, it's been painted, it's been spackled, it's been swept, and we've been able to take on some projects that we never could have had we not been gifted this time. So we're actually in a pretty exciting spot. So I know I could be talking about, you know, lemons and lemonade and all of that, but that's really what has happened here at Penland.
You are planning to have a season this summer, if I'm correct.
Mm-hmm. We're actually planning to start a little earlier than that. We're planning a spring season, which starts second week of March. Okay. And we decided that we just have to plan for the future, and then we will take every day as it comes. But if you don't plan for the future, you cannot put it in place if it shows up. So yes, we are planning for a spring session, and we're planning for a summer session. Now it's going to look very different, because we're only going to have about 60% of our students in our studios. We have to separate everybody, and you know, we have to do some of our instruction via these cameras that we can set up on the instructor and the demonstrator, and we can project it on a large screen instead of having everybody come in really close and look. And people are not going to eat in our beautiful dining hall. We have to have people take their food to other places on campus, and we cannot have people in shared housing. We have to spread people out, but it's going to be doable, of course, with everybody wearing masks and separating. So we're really hoping that we can pull this off, and it's not just financially, it's just because we need to get back to some semblance of normalcy.
Well, I know you will be successful. I can say that at an organization where we've had to pivot many times, I know what those challenges can be like. But Penland is capable of doing it. And I'm envious about the fact that you've cleaned all the gutters and spackled everything and you're ready to go. So that's awesome. I also want to say that I think that when we do reach the other side of whatever this new normal is, that so many people are going to need creative outlets. Mm-hmm. People that never knew that they might desire to be involved in craft. And I think that also one of the gifts, to be positive, is that the pandemic has helped us see how important simplicity can be in life. Mm-hmm. And reclaiming our own expression of what it is to live life and to seek purpose, if you will. For me, in some strange way, and I'm not even sure how to put this into words, Mia, but you know, the creative life is about seeking purpose, some kind of expression, if we go back to where we started, of that interior knowledge that maybe is not what happens in our educational system, which seems to be so linear, but in a more of a circular way of the creativity of life bending back upon itself. So I think there's going to be pent-up demand for craft. Mm-hmm. I hope.
Yeah.
I wanted to mention here that we've got a lot of people watching, and if anyone has something they would like for me to explore with Mia, if you want to type out a question, I can see it. And I'm happy to try to do some of that if you have questions for us. What about your own? I mean, I know what it's like to be in a position of leadership, and sometimes it's hard to find time for my own creativity in a position of leadership. What's that balance like for you? Are you getting into the studio much, and are you able to jump into what you'd like to do as well? And what's maybe the current stuff?
Yeah, the my first year here, I did a little bit more simply because I had an exhibition scheduled and I wasn't about to pull out of that. So I made a small body of work. And of course, I'm a woodworker and we have a beautiful wood studio here. So part of it was just wanting to be in that environment. And then last year I took a week after the holidays and I spent the week in the studio and I have to say that the urge is lesser and lesser. And I think I get that for me, the creative thing has always been about problem solving. And I love that problem solving. I love building and figuring things out. And, you know, a pandemic budget took care of that problem solving need. So I feel like I get so much, I just get so much out of working in this position here at Penland, just seeing what we can do for other artists that I have less and less of a need to go into the studio myself. Mm. I know that's not necessarily the answer people are looking for. I sneak in there now and then. I make a couple of pieces a year. I try to make sure that I make a piece that I'm really happy with for our big benefits auction, because how can I ask hundreds of our artists to donate their beautiful artwork if I'm not willing to go spend the time and make artwork myself. And I'm getting more and more into collaborations with people. That's very fulfilling. So,
yeah. So several questions have popped up, and one was about someone that probably joined us late and didn't hear the history about Penland and Kanuga. And I'm not going to go back and repeat that, but just say to the person submitting the question, it'd be great to look into Rufus and Lucy Morgan, and you'll see that wonderful connection. But there are many questions right now that people are asking about crafting the future and what you are doing with that program. And so I'm wondering if you might speak to that for a few minutes, Mia.
Oh, absolutely. I'm so incredibly proud of the people who came up with the idea and created the initiative. This was, of course, this is not really my story to tell because I've been on the sidelines of this. But since I'm being asked, I am gonna tell the story. Corey Pemberton and Annie Evelyn were two artists here at Penland. Annie was a resident and Corey was a core fellow. And a number of years ago, they got into a conversation about the fact that the craft field as a whole is very white, and Penland is not very diverse either. And they felt frustration about that. Why can't we see more diversity? Why can't our programs be made available to more people of color? So two summers ago, they decided to stop talking about it and just do something. So their very first initiative was just to raise money. They said, we want to raise, I think it was $4,000 to send one student to Penland for a summer class. It was very simple, very straightforward. Well, they raised enough money for two people to come. So they worked with a program in New Orleans called Yaya and sent two students to Penland summer of 2019. And it was really wonderful to have those two students here, and Corey and Annie decided that this was something they wanted to do more of. So instead of just putting up a request for people to donate money, they started reformulating it into a membership program, they solidified Crafting the Future as an initiative. And then this summer happened. George Floyd, the tragedy with George Floyd happened and shook our whole society. And that initiative became one that people felt that they could, in a very direct way, affect change. So they, over the summer, raised, I think, about $175,000, and they had some grant funding to go with that. I felt very compelled to help, and told them that if they raise enough money for a couple of scholarships, Penland will match a couple of scholarships. But I also asked them if they would take that offer to the next craft school and say, hey, so-and-so is doing this, can you do that or more? And they managed to use that as a little bit of leverage and have commitments from a number of the craft schools. That was really great. However, running a big nonprofit and having seen a number of smaller nonprofits, because I serve on a charitable foundation board, so I often get to interact with very small nonprofits or fledgling initiatives like this. I just got a little afraid that their really great idea would just shrivel up and die on the vine because it is so much work. So the Penland staff came together and came and asked me, can't we help them? What can Penland do? So we offered to become their fiscal sponsor and become their mentor organization. So we now help them with whatever they need help with. Right now it's setting up bookkeeping. Our goal is to get them to the point where they are their own 501c3 and that they can, you know, spread their wings and fly. But until then, we're gonna try to stick with them and nurture them and make sure that we can put our resources at their disposal. Mm-hmm. So yes, that's crafting the future.
Yes, thank you for that. There's a question that I really like here from someone that clearly has explored their own creativity and asking basically, you know, I'm interested in a lot of different art forms. Mm-hmm. What's a good way to focus on one? Or two. The question is, do you have insight on how to focus on something? I love the question.
Oh boy. Well, that's a hard one to answer. Back in my academic day, I actually taught a class that was one of my favorite classes to teach, and it was just called Contemporary Craft. And for 16 weeks, I would go through, we had an assignment in fabric dyeing and silk painting, and we did some woodworking, we did some metalsmithing, we did some blacksmithing and a ceramics project. So of course, with just 16 weeks, you can't go into depth in anything, but it was really great because some people would get their hands into a material and really fall in love with it and go off to that department. So I would say, try to find one of those. I don't know where you would find that, because we don't teach like that at Penland. We teach, you know, a singular, in a singular studio. So we don't do a smorgasbord like that. But the other thing I can recommend is a whole summer at Penland. You know, you could take 7 classes if you just enroll in the whole summer.
Wow. Boy, that would be great. thanks for that. I there's so many questions rolling now, and it's beautiful to see. And one of the ones is asking us both to consider the spiritual element of creativity and crafting, and how does the spiritual aspect speak to contemporary social issues And so I thought I'd let you go at that first, Mia.
Oh, boy.
Not unrelated to crafting the future. So
no, I was going to go in a slightly different, different direction. And I'm hoping that we're at a place right now where maybe we, as a society, can kind of pause for a second. We're so driven by consumerism, and you know, we buy more and more and more and more, and often we don't necessarily stop and think about the objects that we use. I know that Jim Hackney is on this call here, and I had wanted to call him out a little earlier, but I know we can't bring him into this conversation technically. But I know that Jim, who works at Kanuga, has a very large ceramics collection. And I know that Jim every morning drinks out of a handmade coffee mug. I don't think Jim would be caught dead with a mug from Target. I had wanted to ask him what does that mean? Why is that so important? I look at things in a very similar way. I do like my handmade mugs. I like things that have meaning and that have value, and I myself, I'm trying to really scale back on always buying new and always buying more, and really think about the objects that I do buy and to spend a little bit more time with that object. A handmade mug is going to cost me 6 or 8 times what a mug from Target is going to cost. So it's an investment, but it is also an investment into someone else's livelihood. I know that I'm not just paying for a mass-produced mug. I'm paying for someone else to have a career in craft. So that's how I'm trying to spend the money that I'm going to spend on handmade,
right,
objects.
So if I were to answer that, since this person asked for both of our perspectives, I have to answer as someone from the Christian tradition. And for me, the very basic notion of who we are is we are incarnate beings. And so to hold craft is to hold something of someone else, to be entrusted with someone else's expression, someone else's life, and therefore to be invited into a kind of intimacy. And while it might be an object, for me, it's a reflection of the incarnation in that person. And the way that I understand Christianity is that every person is a portion, if you will, of God's self-portrait in the world. And so it is our diversity, it is our differentness that actually elevates our understanding, not only of ourselves and others, but also God. And so I might hold something as simple as a mug, but it's an invitation into seeing humanity and thus the divine more clearly. And it is the diversity of that expression that leads me to what I believe is the beauty of the world and God's holiness in the world. A mug that some people might not call successful might be beautiful because it's representing that person's soul and that person's life. And then I could go on and on about the connections to social justice and how that is manifest in the world. But I'll just leave it at, if we're trying and attempting in our daily life to see each other more clearly as gifts of God that reveal the diversity of God's expression in the world, then that leads us to a place where we have to have responsibility for what happens for all of humanity. So,
that's so beautifully said. That's what I wanted to say, but
oh, no.
You really put that into words.
Well, someone is asking for you to repeat the quotation from the very beginning about using your physical body. I think it came out of the video, just some paraphrase. Or is that video available on the Penland website?
I believe so, yes. But Patrick Beggs said, using your physical body to make the thoughts in your mind come into the world. And then he continues to say, there's nothing much more beautiful than that. But yeah. Mm-hmm.
That's wonderful.
Yeah, that is a great, great quote.
So we don't have much time left here. We're almost at the top of the hour. I'm wondering, Mia, if there's anything about Penland or craft that we haven't said that you would like to share with us before we close together.
Oh, boy. Penland, it's a really remarkable place to work. And the reason for that is because of what we get to be part of every single day here. And I think you can probably draw very clear parallels to Kanuga and what you're doing there. We so very often have people come to us and say, this has been a life-changing experience. And that was not something that I had expected coming to Penland. I knew this was going to be good. I knew this was a good place. I knew I believed in the mission. I believed in the educational philosophy and everything. But I had not been, I hadn't witnessed the impact on people, and that has been pretty remarkable to see that over these 3 years. And it's we say that all the time. People, you know, Penland changes lives, and it's not something that we've heard once or twice, and we kind of grab it as a tagline. We hear it. I have people come into my office and want to tell me that. And I hear it from people who had that happen 50, 60 years ago. Cynthia Bringle, Edwina Bringle, they came here, I think it was 60 years ago, and had that experience and never left. And they're still here. They're in their 80s and they're still active artists and very much part of our community. So we get to see that day in and day out. And that's a very powerful experience that I'm so grateful that I get to do this. I get to be part of making this available for people. You know, I do have some goals and some dreams for Penland for the next decade, and that is to make it available to more people to remove some of the obstacles for people to come here and to attend Penland and to see, you know, more diversity, to see more equity in what we do. But yeah, it's a pretty cool place.
It is indeed. And Mia, I just want to thank you for taking an hour to have this conversation. I have enjoyed every single minute. It's been so much fun for me. Thank you for what you do there, for how you continue to celebrate craft and help us see its value. And let's both look forward to that day when our staff can come back together again and you all can come to Kanuga and world returns to somewhat normal and we can explore more together. But yeah. Just thanks for this time.
Thank you. And I think we do have a lot of crossover. Our staff did go to Kanuga about a month and a half ago and spent a couple of days, and it has a very similar feeling when you come onto the campus. And you know, we think in very similar ways. So yes, I too look forward to a time of normalcy when we can do more together.
Absolutely. Well, thank you again, Mia. I hope you have a great evening, and thanks to everyone that joined us tonight.
Thank you.
This will be available. We'll post this to Facebook and other online platforms. So if you've enjoyed this and you want to see part of it again, you'll be able to tune in later. Thanks so much. God's peace. Bye-bye.
Good night. Good night.